for today's episode, I wanted to go over some of the thought process that goes into deciding on what to review for Horrible Horrors. You see, there are plenty of films out there that I would love to completely fanboy out about, discuss how much I love them, and what kind of impact they've made on me. However, that doesn't result in views. You see, example, these are the page views of a review in which I gush over the movie and talk about how much I love it. People are interested. Here is an example of a video where I completely shit all over the movie because it sucked. And it was from the 90s. You could see a lot more views. So with all that in mind, for today's review, regardless of who directed it, or how much of an influence it had on me, or whether or not it's a favorite, not going to become some blithering fanboy. This is a review show after all, and it's my job to look at each film critically and nitpick things in a comedic fashion. Oh, the movies, they live! Now, They Live starts in a grim look at 1988. Excess is the buzzword, and the majority of middle to lower class Americans are in the poorhouse. Our hero is Nada, a down-on-his-luck construction worker played by Roddy Piper, who finds refuge in a small nomad group. There he meets Frank, who helps him get a meal and some work. Soon, the church of the homeless nomads gets attacked by a group of cops, seemingly for no reason. Once Nada investigates, he sees that the church was a resistance group and finds several pair of sunglasses. He discovers that said resistance had happened upon a global conspiracy perpetuated by an alien race to keep humans lethargic, quiet, and obedient. The sunglasses allow him to see what is really there, as opposed to what said alien race wants him to see. A pretty heavy idea. And as such, I feel it's a very good jumping-off point to outline what are the strong qualities of this film. The good. Number one, the concept. The whole idea of this film is absolutely outstanding, and has struck a chord in popular culture since the release of this film. The dialogue, the music, the subliminal messaging, the sunglasses, all of it has continued to show up in culture long past the release date of this film. The whole idea of being controlled or being subjected to things without our knowledge is a very creepy thought, and the film does an excellent job of conveying the gravity of the situation while maintaining a witty and rather upbeat demeanor. Number 2. Roddy Piper. Now in the 80s, professional wrestling had become a huge commercial commodity. As such, several performers were trying to branch out into film. At this same time, director John Carpenter happened to see WrestleMania 3 and was blown away by one of the performers who was so over the top that his mic skills outweighed his wrestling skills. That performer was Roddy Piper. Now, his character in They Live is much more subdued than his wrestling persona, but his gift for one-liners shined through.
Where'd you get those glasses?
Tooth fairy.
This one?
Real f***ing ugly.
Life's a b***.
Formaldehyde face, that's what we got.
She's back in heat.
That's like pouring perfume on a pig.
Some, of course, being absolute gems.
Mama don't like tattletales.
And other ones being a little more straightforward.
Don't f*** with me.
He also turns in a moving and exciting performance that impressed critics and film snobs alike. This would not be a decent review of this film if, of course, we did not discuss the fight scene in it. Now, many films have iconic fights in them, but none quite like this. Nada and Frank fight in an alley for 7.5 minutes.
Told you, I didn't want to be in.
Over sunglasses. 7 minutes, no music, no intense slow-mos or close-ups, just two men beating each other up for several minutes. Why is this fight of any interest? Because it is stuck in pop culture. It was there enough for South Park to do a scene-by-scene replica of the fight in an episode, with two handicapped kids. The bad. Number one, pacing. They Live is a definitive example of a director taking his sweet time with things. The story crawls in the beginning. Shots are drawn out, the nomad worker camp is shown in grueling detail. We get little snippets of character and some bitchin' shots of Roddy Piper shirtless
for the ladies.
But the real meat and potatoes of the story doesn't kick in until about 2/3 of the way through. Granted, it's one hell of a story, but the introduction to the concept does seem to drag. Number 2. Plot twists. The other big issue I have with this film is, I guess, what you would call plot twists. Now, of course, I don't mean the big reveal that there's aliens and subliminal messaging, because that is all absolutely awesome. I'm talking about the moments that feel like John Carpenter wrote himself into a corner and farted something out to get back on track. For instance, after Roddy Piper is done shooting aliens and spouting catchphrases, he reluctantly takes a woman hostage, and she in turn takes him to her house to duck the cops. Then, when they run out of dialogue, she smashes a glass over his head, which sends him toppling out of a window. That's it? That's our transition? Well, that's one way to have a jump cut. What is this? I'm here to see Roddy Piper play Bruce Campbell, not Puma Man.
Oops, sorry! I'm fine. I used up a perfectly good pants wetting for that.
Or Nada and Frank trapped in an alleyway when a giant get-out-of-jail-free hole appears. Or whoops, they're suddenly a couple. It just feels choppy. It's like they were building this big story and there were little snippets in the between. They were like, oh, what are we going to do about this? So they just scribbled something and moved on. Final thoughts. Between Roddy Piper, the only other survivor from The Thing, and the hobo from Back to the Future, this film is exquisite. And as far as John Carpenter projects go, it's one of the more deeper ones out there. I honestly can't tell you what the deeper meaning is behind Halloween, or Christine, other than it's a Stephen King movie, or Ghosts of Mars. I don't know. But with this one, there's a definitive message and one that we need to take to heart. Recently, it has come out that advertisers have had to start slipping ads into shows instead of keeping it restricted to the commercial breaks. This isn't product placement, this is subliminal goddamn messaging. Here's a screenshot from an episode of How I Met Your Mother, when it originally aired. And here's a screenshot from that same episode, but in syndication. Notice the background? That would be an ad for Paul Blart Zookeeper photoshopped onto the bookshelf of a show that is supposed to take place within a strict timeline. They've been caught doing this tactic on other episodes as well. What John Carpenter warned us about is happening. Now is the time for us to stand and for us to fight. We cannot be lulled into a false sense to where the powerful can become more powerful. Now is the time for you to stand up, to create, to use your mind, to not allow the human element to die. I am Zach Romero. I am a voice for the voiceless. Wolverines!
Is that idiot licking his nuts again?
Come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
I'm here to kick ectoplasm and chew bubblegum, and I'm fresh out of bubblegum.
I have come here to chew sushi and kick butt, and I'm all out of sushi.
It's time to kick ass and chew bubblegum, and I'm all out of gum.
I am here to eat candy canes and kick ass, and I'm all out of candy canes.
I came here to drink milk and kick ass. And I've just finished.